Johnson, and I'm interviewing James W. Milligan, goes by Jim. I appreciate you coming today. First of all, give me your full name and where you're from and your mom and dad's names.
I am James Wynn Milligan. My mother was Margaret Shira Wynn Milligan. My father was James Stuart Milligan.
And where did they come from? What area?
Well, they were both from Indiana. My father was born and raised on a farm just north, about 8 miles north of Spencer, Indiana, in Owen County. My mother was from a town called Grammar, which is just east of Columbus, Indiana. The only town I know of named Grammar.
we're going to go into your Army experience, but tell me, teenage years going up into the Army, what led you to your service?
Well, following my 16th birthday, I was quite interested in amateur radio. And 1 week, the Saturday prior to Pearl Harbor, December 7th, I went to Chicago and passed the examination for license as an amateur radio operator. Then Pearl Harbor occurred 8 days later. I didn't get my ticket for 9 months, but I used that very effectively in my Army experience. So I well remember exactly where I was in Pearl Harbor, as most people can.
What was your date of birth?
November 25th, 1924. I'll be 75 in it next month.
Tell me about, you were 16. Give me a little overview of leading you up to, you were drafted or did you enlist?
When I graduated from high school in June of 1942, the following semester, I went to Purdue and completed my that year. This was wartime, obviously. Most of the guys of my age were encouraged to join the Enlisted Reserve Corps. I well remember a big headline in the Purdue student paper called The Exponent: "Join the Enlisted Reserve Corps and stay in school, Elliot." Elliot was the president of the university. So most of the guys joined. I did not. Midway through the spring semester, the Enlisted Reserve Corps was activated. And I thought, gosh, all of the guys of my age are going in. I might as well volunteer for induction. So I chose to volunteer for induction, went in voluntarily. When I went in, we were at the reception center at Fort Benjamin Harrison in Indianapolis. Here were all of my buddies that were in the Enlisted Reserve Corps, and I was right with them. As a group, we were shipped to Camp Walters, Texas, which was an infantry replacement training center. We were told that the reason that this young group of college kids, I'll say kids because we were 18, 19, were shipped to the infantry replacement training center was that the average AGCT score, which is the Army General Classification Test score, was getting too low in the infantry, and the Army wanted to bring it up. And as a result of that, there were a lot of pretty intelligent young men in the infantry. And this type of thing, and of course a lot of them propagated after basic into ASTP. And it was many of this group that saved the U.S. in Battle of the Bulge in the Ardennes. PFCs, commanding companies, and this sort of thing.
Tell me about, are you aware of any difference in training between a replacement Was there anything different in the replacement training than it was in just the regular training? Or was the course shorter, or?
Oh. Our basic started out as 15 weeks, then was lengthened to 17 weeks, and then further lengthened to 19 weeks. And it was very intensive. I used my amateur ticket, as a licensed radio amateur, to get it. I wanted to get into a specialized training battalion, 52nd training battalion at Camp Walters. The radio battalion was filled, but I was put in the wire in the wire company. Told that when some guys flunked out because they couldn't master the code, that I would be put in. 4 or 5 weeks later, I was transferred, and we had pretty good basics in infantry training. Fired for record with an M1 three times, and fired expert. I got so that I could handle a rifle very, very effectively, and learn how to fall and creep and crawl and all the sorts of things that go into training. Possibly a better background than a better background than some of the fellows had that were in the armored infantry. I don't know, because I haven't discussed it, this type of detail very much. But it didn't hurt me. But I was trained as an Army radio operator in the infantry, with pack radios, and I was a CW operator. With code, this type of thing. Had a lot of fun with that, but we'd go out on encampments and until they recognized my fist. A fist is the way you actually transmit with a key. Fellas would get me to transmit all the messages, to receive everything, and they'd sit back and drink. And, well, fine. I could do it. It kept me occupied. Army life is either very intensive or total boredom. I'd rather have intensive than boredom.
So the way you keyed, there was a style of the way you did it.
Oh, yes.
People got to where they could understand.
Oh, yeah. Oh, understand and recognize almost it's called a fist, and it's the way you space the dots and the dashes, and a trained person can recognize a fist, and mine was recognized. I was told, hey, Jim, now let the other guys do it. You take your turn. Kind of funny. Well, that's enough of this.
Well, get us on over to Camp Barkley. How'd you get there?
Well, I applied for ASDP because I wasn't sure I wanted to be shipped to an infantry division. And I didn't want to have to walk everywhere. I had developed enough blisters in my heels and the like. I had a blister upon a blister upon a blister on each heel. And I must have had a hole in my heel about a quarter of an inch deep from those darn blisters, and I didn't want to have to walk everywhere. So I applied for ASDP, was accepted, shipped to a star unit along with a lot of other guys. And the star unit was in Camp Maxey, Texas, just north of Paris. Saw my first German soccer game there. These were all guys from the Africa Corps, that there was a POW camp. We would be sent out to guard them on a work detail. One guy with 5 shells and a 12-gauge pump, shotgun. And those German guys never had it so good. They had 3 square meals a day, and they were safe. But anyway, we were shipped eventually from a star unit to Texas A&M. And I remember spending Christmas at the star unit at Camp Maxey. I must have been at Texas A&M for about 5 weeks.
What's a STAR unit? Is that just the name of your unit?
I don't know what the acronym STAR stands for, but it was kind of a holding unit for guys that were going to be assigned to ASDP before they were actually assigned to a college. But we had some of the older fellows that were more advanced, were teaching courses and helping us brush up on algebra and the trig and calculus and all of this sort of thing, principally math. And it was not totally wasted time, although a good bit of it was. But
tell me about the day you found out that the ASTP was closing. Or had you gotten through your education before?
Oh, no. I just had 1 year at Purdue. And I think I got in those 4 or 5 weeks at Texas A&M, I got something out of it. I learned more about analytical balances there than I ever learned later at Purdue, and how to adjust them in the whole 10 yards. Also had an opportunity to hear a concert violinist in playing concert there, and I was one of the 4 or 5 GIs that had walked over and walked in, so it wasn't all wasted.
Okay, the day that ASTP closed, what was your feelings? What was your feelings, and then the general feelings of the men?
Oh, my feelings were that, well, this is it. We're going to be assigned to a combat unit. I wasn't disappointed as such. I was relieved when we were assigned to this 12th Armored Division. One-third of us, I counted the roster, or measured the names in the roster. One-third of us were assigned to the 12th Armored Division, two-thirds to the 99th Infantry. And it was strictly the luck of the draw. And I could discern no rationale for, maybe they chose every third man to go to the 12th. It could have been some kind of, or a random selection. And I was relieved when we were assigned to an armored division rather than an infantry division that I had tried to avoid.
So it was just a general acceptance of it.
Oh, yes.
No negative feelings.
Oh, no. No negative feelings of no better disappointment or this sort of thing. No, I didn't sense that at all.
What was your general experience at Camp Barkley? And was it what you expected?
I didn't know what to expect, really. I'm not even sure that I had seen much military equipment before, although that my freshman year at Purdue in ROTC, we had trained on French 75 howitzers, but obviously no firing, just through the motions. But I think in general the experience at Barkley was good. About 3 weeks after I got there, I was assigned to the 66th. I was one of the later men to be interviewed by, I think, a company clerk. And I said, I was trained as a radio operator at Walters. And again, I pulled out my amateur ticket. He said, "Well, Jim, we don't have any assignments. We don't have any slots for radio operators." Then he looked and searched and, "Well, yeah, I can make you a radio operator in the assault gun platoon in the 66th.
Of what?
Of the assault gun platoon. So I showed up there. "What's an assault gun?" "Well, an assault gun literally was a light tank chassis with an open cast steel turret mounting a 75 millimeter pack howitzer. And we literally went into combat with that light armament. And that'll come later."
Any specific person that stands out in your mind in your Marvel experience? Even officer?
Had my first impression of Colonel Wells there. He was a major at that time. The 56th Armored Infantry Regiment had just been divided into the new, quote, new organization, I guess, where each individual battalion was self-sustaining and organized into combat commands with an infantry battalion, a tank battalion, and the support units. We, after I had been there, a week or so, Colonel Wells took the entire battalion out for about a 16-mile hike with full pack and a rifle. Well, it seems that he caught some of the officers riding jeeps, wearing very light packs, and I well remember that weekend. He got all the officers in his battalion, personally inspected everyone, and took the officers for another 20-mile hike. And some of us, I kind of, of course, you couldn't stand and watch, but some of us observed that. And that is the type of thing, that was one of my first impressions of then Major Wells, that he thought enough of his men that he wasn't going to let his officers slough things off, which was good. I have some further comments on Colonel Wells.
Okay, let's get to, let's get over to Europe. I mean, if
sure.
You have memories of things that got, you know, between those times.
Oh, sure.
Okay.
We were, our point of embarkation was Camp Lucky Strike, of course, in New Jersey. And I got a couple of 12-hour passes into New York City, first time I had been in New York, and which was interesting. And sometimes it looked interesting, but boring. And got all of our shots. Boy, did that type of shot sting. I still remember that. Fellows were fainting and, literally fainting from the reaction to this shot of typhus. And I did not, but I still remember the sting. They shipped overseas on the Empress of Australia. Took us about 2 weeks. Going over in a convoy, the largest convoy that had been shipped to Europe at that time, 106 vessels. And I still remember the destroyers dancing around between the troop ships and the transports, the cargo ships and the like. Had a sub-scare. All of the GIs were principally below decks. We had one officer in our battalion, in our headquarters company, that was pretty rough on his men. He stayed in his stateroom. I will not name him by name. He stayed in his stateroom with a loaded 45 by his side. There was one officer that we heard about from another unit that disappeared. These are things that happen. And but this man, during this particular officer, when he got overseas, he was transferred to a different unit, and I understand was a very, very good officer. His men were well trained, and the lieutenant that took over that particular platoon, it was not my platoon, but I was aware of what was going on. We were at Tidworth Barracks in England. World War I squad tents with a conical shaped tin stoves. I'm sure you've heard this many times. Brewed coffee in about a gallon or one of these large gallon cans. Just put coffee grounds and water and cracked an egg in it to settle the coffee grounds. This type of thing. Hey, it works. worked well. And it was just small enough to fit inside this conical-shaped wood peat-burning stove. And got into London a couple of times. Oh, once. Heard the V2s come over. Saw a lot of the damage, the V2 damage, on the way in of the train. We embarked across the channel. We were assigned, our assault gun platoon was assigned to an LST. We embarked at the port of Southampton from Tidworth Barracks. The crossing the channel, abruptly, one morning, we felt this ship shake and stop dead in the water. Now, keep in mind, this was in November, early November. A couple of the Navy guys went over the fantail, dove down, came up, white-faced, literally white-faced. Wouldn't say a word to any of us. And I saw a signalman take the cover off the blinker. So I told one of my buddies, you write down what I tell you. So I read the blinker, and being trained as a radio operator, we had dropped one of the twin screws. And the communication was to the convoy commander, and about 5 minutes got a message back: convoy has to go ahead, come in under your own steam. So we limped in. It took us 5 days to cross the channel, all alone. And we were assigned the inflatable life belts. About that wide, two strips of that could be inflated from carbon dioxide bottles. Are we okay? Okay. The guys took great sport and just come up and just kicking these bottles to inflate the life vest. Well, we got to the point where we were getting very short of those carbon dioxide, the little bottles. They were about that long, about that big a diameter. And I went to my platoon leader, Lieutenant Alan B. Canfield at the time, and told him what was happening. And he said, "Jim, here, you take all the bottles. Now on you dispense them." I had guys come to me. We literally got down where we had one of those CO2 bottles per man. I gave one of my buddies one of my two bottles that I had in my life vest. I mean, things like this happened. This was November. If we had been sunk, we couldn't have lasted more than half an hour in those cold waters. Crossing the Empress of Australia, we had Kapok cushions, two of them, roughly about that big square. And those things wouldn't have kept us afloat more than 30 minutes. But that's what, that was it. We got rejoined when we landed at Lahore. We rejoined our unit. It was almost like we walked in from the dead. They thought we had been sunk. We had been lost. It would have been I think we had two of our M8 assault guns and one M4A3 tank from one of the tank battalions on board. Oh, another thing that happened on this LST. Since it took so long for us to cross, we ran out of regular chow. And they served the Army. The Navy cooks served the Army Navy beans. That was it. We went to our officers and said, "Hey, look, we're literally all on this boat together. We either all eat beans or we eat regular chow." Our officers went to the Navy, whoever was the captain of that LST, said, "We're going to have a rat in our hands." And I'll tell you, we outnumber you. The next meal, they broke out everything from the larder. Ice cream, beef, and it was a feast. The next meal, everyone, officers included, Navy beans. And one Navy chief, he was one of the older guys. I'll be 75 next month. This guy was one of the older guys. He must have been in his late 30s. And he said, "I've been in the Navy 25 years, and this is the first time I've ever had to eat Navy beans." I remember his comment. Well, that's one of the funny things that happened.
Tell us about the feelings as you finally lived in. Did you land at Lahore?
Yes.
What was your impressions? What was it like for you? As y'all landed, or was it just too busy? But general experience of that.
Thankful to be on land. And obviously we were all I think we only had tanks. I don't think we had our half racks yet. I think the fellows whose tanks were on board, of course, had those vehicles, and I think the rest of us were put in 6x6 trucks and taken to our unit. We were just thankful to be on land. That's all, and glad to be back with our unit. And then we picked up our vehicles and. Half track, the rest of our equipment. We had all of our equipment with us. And on the LST, we had the privilege of sleeping in bunks with about 12 inches of headroom. I mean, between bunks, probably about 4 inches of headroom. And on the Empress, on the Empress of Australia, I remember hearing that she had transported German prisoners stateside, and the ship had not been fumigated and there were body lice in those hammocks. And taking a shower in salt water is not fun. Not fun. Oops, sorry.
It's part of your experience. Get me into the first battle, the first action that you saw, and the feelings, the first reactions of that.
The first time I experienced combat, I was an observer, almost a detached observer. I was carrying roughly 80 pounds of radio and batteries with a lieutenant Canfield, and it was at Singling. And we were up on a rise overlooking this town, and it was dark, so no one really knew we were there, but we were observing. And I saw a German tank at a range of about 3,500 yards knock out or destroy one of our M4E3 tanks with one round from the 88. And that impressed me very much. And other fellows saw it too, that having one of our tanks knocked out with one round from an 88 range of about 3,500, and that was my lieutenant's estimate of range, because he was reacting the same way I was. I don't think our assault guns fired at that time. And we went down after we had taken the town, and tossed some more of like our guys, and I think if everyone realized that that tank had been knocked out at that range, knew what we were up against. Maybe it was a lucky shot, but it's the type of thing that can really get one's attention. So.
Was it a sense of the magnitude of the force you were facing, or was it just the first sight of war?
Probably the first sight of war and the first hard realization that of what we were up against. And our tanks were armed with 75 millimeter relatively short rifles, and no way were they a match for the German tanks who were armed with the 88s. Our self guns with their little 75 millimeter pack howitzers, and the tube, the barrel on that pack howitzer couldn't have been more than 30 inches long, and I knew what those vehicles would be facing if they ever confronted, as one of them did later. We pulled back then, and there were my next memory, there were other actions where we were not directly involved, but our tanks had been involved, one of our tank battalions. Tracks about in mud, and they bellied down, they made tracks, I heard, about 2 feet deep. And one officer was in one of those tracks, and a shell burst in that track, and the concussion killed him. first man killed in our outfit was our company medic. Right through the center of his Red Cross in his heart. That kind of got us. He was a good friend of mine. So.
You and headquarters company. Tell me about the organization that and the man that you work with closely. Kind of describe that experience, maybe the headquarters and those personnel.
Right. A headquarters company was comprised of three combat platoons. We had the platoon of assault guns that I've already described. We had three of the M8 assault guns. We had a heavy mortar platoon armed with 81 millimeter mortars. And then we had a heavy machine gun platoon. And then we had a fourth platoon that was kind of service and vehicle maintenance and this type of thing. Although we had a service company as part of the battalion. In addition to that, battalion headquarters comprised the commanding officer, Colonel Wells, who had been promoted to lieutenant colonel at that time. And an executive officer who would take over in case the colonel was killed. Then we had S1, S2, S3, and S4 providing intelligence and support and this type of thing. And together with the battalion radio operators, there were four battalion radio operators that I got to know. I was billeted with three of them, I think, while we were at Barclay. So I got to know the fellows reasonably well. They had a pretty easy life in Barclay.
Story about Colonel Wells in Barclay. Describe him in battle. Describe him as a leader of men and some things about him.
I think I've got, I remember one time while we were in France, we were at a chateau. This is before singing, prior to singing. And he talked about how we could keep ourselves clean with a canteen full of water. He suggested, number one, shave and wash critical areas in your body. And the important areas were armpits, crotch, behind your knees, and feet. Don't worry about anything else. And that proved to be wise. A wise suggestion. In battle, after our A and C companies had attacked, they crossed four footbridges that were thrown across the Lynn-Graben Canal at the Steinwald Forest. The 66th was not at Herbesheim, per se, but at Steinwald, as you, as you well know. After they had been decimated, They jumped off at prior to dawn that morning, that night. That night, I remember walking back and forth in front of Colonel's squad tent with raised voices. And about 2 o'clock in the morning, we got orders to take this stiff canvas off the top of our half tracks and get the vehicles. And we had orders that every vehicle that mounted a weapon was going to attack at dawn with every vehicle abreast. About 4 o'clock that same morning, we got orders to put that stiff canvas back on. I was walking back and forth in front of this tent, but part of this line, and it took Colonel Well. He had received a direct order from one of our generals. I think I know which one, but I will not name him, to attack with every vehicle abreast. And it took Colonel Wells 5 hours to refuse that order. He didn't refuse it. He couldn't refuse it directly, of course. He would have been court-martialed on the spot and removed from command. But he apparently persuaded the general to move from that position to a flanking position that was a little more defensible. And that's what we ultimately did. And the colonel was responsible for that. Talking with another man who was a personal friend of Colonel Wells at that time, and, well, I don't know if you can call a personal friend, but fairly close to him, and saw Colonel Wells several times after World War II. Said that he had remained in the Army and was not promoted further for an incident. Then I related this incident that I just related to you and said, yep, that's it, yep, that was it. And he sacrificed his Army career for his men. We moved to this flanking position, and he literally saved our next event. There was another time in right at the end of, just before the PE day, we were driving from Dillingen south to the town of Overall. I had been pulled up to battalion headquarters as a radio operator, as one of the two replacements for a couple of radio operators that had been injured by shrapnel, an airburst. And I took the message and decoded it personally of that, ordered the colonel to take his task force to drive south as fast as he could to the town of Oberau. For the first time, Colonel Wells, that I knew of, Colonel Wells sent out his intelligence and reconnaissance platoon, scout the area, report back, and then he moved up, strict, right by the book. And it's not the way we had been operating. And there was a task force. Oh, the orders also read that there was a task force from the 10th Armored driving south to the same intersection along a parallel road. Whichever task force got to that intersection first was to go on and take Innsbruck. We got to Oberau, and we're told that the 10th Task Force and the 10th Armored got there about 2 hours before that, going to Innsbruck. I read in Stars and Stripes about 10 days later, I wish I had that article, that there was a task force of the 10th Armored that had gotten to a mountain road overlooking Innsbruck with zigzag hairpin loops down the mountainside. The entire task force, the Germans knocked out the first vehicle, the last vehicle, and then the turkey shoot from clear on. They suffered a 90% casualty rate. Colonel Wells.
Yeah. He's a man of
character. Strictly. A man of real character. I observed him in some situations where there may have been some hanky-panky going on with women and the like. I never observed that with Colonel Wells. Never. I don't know. Excuse me. Shut it off for a minute, please. Tell it. Another experience I had with Colonel Wells was when I think it was in the Colmar area. It may have been in a different area. I don't quite recall. But again, I had taken a message and decoded it. For the colonel's eyes only, that he could rotate one officer in his command back stateside. And the colonel looked at me and said, "Jim, you and I are the only ones that know this. Who would you suggest?" And I said, "Well, sir," I thought for a minute. He was kind of stern. Almost saying, "Come on, you know." I said, "Well, sir, I would suggest Major so-and-so. I won't mention his name for the record." He said, "Major, what? Why? Why him?" I said, "Well, sir, been my observation that he didn't have the sense to come in out of the rain. And if something happens to you, he would very logically be given your command to get us all killed." He kind of started, left, and said, "Jim, I'll be back in about 5 minutes. I'll let you know who I said." And in about 3 minutes, he came back and said, "Jim, would you tell Major so-and-so to report to me, please?" So this officer was rotated back stateside. I shared this with another guy whom I know in our outfit, who was commissioned, and said, "That's the reason we always wondered why Major so-and-so was rotated. Why did he deserve it over all the guys in his action?" Well, that's kind of one of the funny things. Of course, he swore me to secrecy at that time. But that was, I'm the only one in our battalion that could share a couple of these stories with me.
So you were in very close, you had the personal one-on-one relationship with Trump.
Oh, not close. But I think over, relatively short period of time that I was in battalion headquarters as a radio operator. I was certainly not a bosom companion, obviously. But I think he may have recognized that here's a young kid that's getting dry behind the ears. I think I've always thought that perhaps led him to trust my judgment. Another experience that I had with Colonel Wells was at Milligan. After patrol from A Company had crossed this concrete bridge that was lasted until, at least I saw it, in 1983, now destroyed, we were in a hotel. We took over a hotel in Dillingham as our battalion headquarters. And that night, Colonel Wells came to me and said, "Jim, do you know any other radio operators that are sober?" "I think I found a wine cellar." And he said, "Jim, do you know any radio operators that are sober?" I said, "No, sir." He said, "Well, I don't know of a single other officer battalion headquarters that's sober. Guess who's going to be the radio operator on duty, and guess who's going to be the OD? By the way, I'll be over here if you need me." So this is kind of a little different side of Colonel Wells than perhaps you may have gotten from other people. I learned after the war, when we were at Ellwangen, that he had been the personnel manager for Diamond Chain in Indianapolis. So he had been a personnel manager and was people-oriented. I didn't realize that in combat. I just observed these small vignettes along the way, which is rather interesting. So, no, he was a very, very fine man. He had to have been.
The 66th is known for Steinwall.
Yes.
Forrest, you hate to say that, but that was not the best time for him. But can you...
That's an understatement.
Yeah. Would you mind telling us about that experience?
Yes. I mentioned these four footbridges earlier that have been thrown across the Landgraben Canal. They were put across by a platoon of engineers that must have been attached to us at that time. I was still a radio operator in the assault gun platoon. And I remember hearing, there was a lot of fire. I suppose that this canal must have been a mile or so from the fort, from the Steinwald forest itself. And I remember we were firing air support. Or not air support, artillery support. And I remember hearing on our radio that the A and C companies had attacked, and they could account for 25 men in one company and about 50 men in the other company. And I heard that on the radio. And that they could account for that many. Thank the Lord, it wasn't quite that severe. But that night, a lot of the guys had filtered back through. There was a long strip of deflet. It was not the canal, but they had gotten back to our lines, and a lot of the fellows captured. It was that night that Colonel Wells had virtually refused his order to attack, to make a frontal assault. We did a flanking movement to the left, and the map is in west Wes's book on C Company. The night after, I remember seeing in the distance at dusk guys probably a mile and a half away, maybe not quite that far, but they were running toward the canal. And that must have been a German patrol. I was on the wrong side to even fire. I reported it immediately. And so far as I know, I'm the only one that saw that patrol. There must have been five or six men. At dusk, after dark, I was ordered by my platoon sergeant to join a patrol led by Vic Carter, who was a sergeant in the machine gun platoon. And our orders were to go back and capture and destroy those four footbridges that had been put across that canal. So we went by half track back to our original position and late at night, midnight, it was dark, you could hardly see your hand in front of your face. We walked out on this ice. I've been back there since then. This is an ice field that is larger than a square mile in area. It was huge. But one of our men, it was so dark that one of our men fell into a foxhole, went over his head in the water. He broke through the ice. Of course, he was sent back. He would have frozen. The rest of us went on, got to the first footbridge, had a little firefight, captured three or four German prisoners, and none of our guys were injured at that time. And the patrol was going to take them back for interrogation. I will have to say an instant of time. I was with this group of men. The next instant, I was totally alone. Totally alone. And I got down on my hands and knees to get oriented. And I saw a tree line in the background that I thought I recognized. So I went over there, started in that direction. Of course, with magnesium mortars or flares going off periodically, sporadic machine gun fire. They knew we were out. The Germans knew we were out there. Some mortars, and I got to a slope, and ice covered. I couldn't walk up. I got down on my hands and knees. I couldn't crawl up. I tried to creep up, hands and toes and scoot forward. I couldn't. I couldn't do it. And I prayed. And I had an immediate answer to prayer, my first one. And my answer to prayer was that the thought was implanted in my mind. I didn't hear a voice, it was just the thought. It was playing in my mind. I pull out my sheath knife, rifle strapped across my back, tap the ice in front, pull up like this, which I did. And it was about, oh, I probably pulled that, probably 40 feet up that slope. Well, I got up there. And I finally found my half track. All the other fellows were in it. They thought I had been killed. And this was all about, I suppose, 3 or 4 o'clock in the morning. And we realized that we hadn't destroyed those footbridges. The reason for destroying those footbridges was to prevent the Germans from using them and flanking our position to attack us from the side, which could have decimated us. So, at first light, we started out in that field of ice again. Oh, we had passed a foxhole with two of my friends in it, Ben Wasserman, from the INR platoon, and Ted Gross, also from the same platoon. And we passed them, and then we went out in this ice. They let us get totally out in the ice. I was the second man from point. Vic Carter was 6-8 yards in front of me. We were all spaced out. Machine gun opened up on us. Vic was hit. The guy behind me was hit. The man behind him was killed. There was another man farther back. My memory was it was continuous burst machine gun fire. I don't have a mark on my body from that experience. So whether I was shielded, whether my infantry training had taught me how to fall immediately, I don't know, but I don't have a mark on my body. I have other scars, but not a bullet mark. And we were pinned down on this ice. It was just about 30 inches or so off the ice. And because we were kind of crouching, and I pegged that because Vic was carrying his carbine, and he was hitting it in the right wrist, and took one round in the gut. And well, I crawled up to Vic when they were pinned down, all under this fire, and see how badly wounded he was. Then I heard and saw a half track backing down one of our half tracks down into Quad 50. It was from an anti-aircraft unit that had been attached to us, to our unit, backing down a slope. And then I heard a yell from Ernie Gunderson, who was our half track driver, this Quad 50 opened up, give us covering fire. Yelled for us to get off the ice. Well, we made a mad dash to, and we got back. Somehow, Vic and I got in a foxhole. I gave him sulfa tablets and this sort of thing. And then we got on somehow. He gave us covering fire. We got on these half tracks. It's one half track. I was holding, Vic and I were hanging on to the hood. There were a couple of other guys on the other side on the hood of this half track. And we were starting down a blacktop road, and the Germans opened up on us with what I thought was a 57, equivalent of a 57 caliber anti tank gun, or heavier. There was also some air burst. Camouflage net had gotten caught around the left front wheel of the axle, and I kept yelling to the driver to stop and let me get that camouflage net off so we could move faster. He was down to a very slow creep. He was in low, low gear with the engine wide open. Couldn't have been doing more than 1.5 miles an hour. He finally stopped, and I was crouched down by that wheel, getting that camouflage net unwound when an airburst, we took some airburst, and some of our guys were wounded. And then there was a shell burst right square between the tracks in the rear that burst upward. And it killed one of the anti-aircraft guys back there. And the other guy is the guy that I helped, but I totally blanked the visual image. And he had to have been critically or fatally wounded. And his face was blown off. And after I got up, having unwound that camouflage net, we started up again, and we took this shell burst between the rear tracks as we were getting up to speed. Vic told me, "Jim, don't put your arms around my shoulders. I've been wounded. The shrapnel. Just hook onto my belt." I was literally holding him on. Well, after that half-track was knocked out, the two or three of us that weren't wounded got our wounded over to a ditch and some cover. And the other guys took off and said, "We're not waiting around here." He said, "I'm not leaving our wounded until I get help." And it took about 20 minutes. Until I find a medic. And finally got this poor kid's face. If that visual image ever comes back, I hope I'm with someone. But we got back. We finally got our wounded back to a first aid station. And I got back to my unit. And then it was that later afternoon that the Germans attacked us with estimated 800 infantry and 50 tanks. But I will remember that field. We had some men ran, some men did not, and I will not name names on camera. But I remember lying in some deathlet and machine gun fire hitting the trees roughly about 4 feet above this deathlet. When the battle was going on, we had orders to pull back to the lines of the 36th Infantry, and we had one of our guys was a little bit, shall I say, sleepy, not in the normal sense, but he wouldn't move, and Bill Valentine picked him up by the feet, and I picked him up by the shoulders, and we literally tossed him in the back of our half-track, and we clambered in on top of him. And we got back, and we picked up. I remember seeing our tank destroyers that had been dug in, and it was a welcome sight to see those 105 rifles on those tank destroyers that were dug in, supporting the 36th. somehow our half-track got, we took a wrong turn. We didn't get back to our unit that night. But I remember being with Sergeant Howery, H-O-W-E-R-Y. And we went into a very peaceful setting. No combat vehicles around there. When we pulled into a large farmyard, parked our half-track behind a brick wall where it was relatively concealed, went in. Now this is Alsace-Lorraine. This is not in Germany. This is just north of Strasbourg. Now, Germans had, it was under German control, but we were just hoping that the local people were all right. And we talked to the people that all we want to do is to find a place to sleep. And we're not going to harm you. Can you show us a place? They took us up to a third, it's a kind of Deutsche Soldaten here. And they took us up to a second floor room that was very isolated. They said, you should be safe here. And we didn't even post a guard that night. We were that tired. Got back to our unit, pulled back to, we finally found the assault gun platoon back in Behrendorf. So, again, we walked in from the dead. They thought we had been killed. And so, but this was a life-changing experience for me, literally.
Before this time, even a man of just living in
that? Oh, I had been raised, and I'd been raised in a church. But it was probably one of the more liberal Presbyterian churches. This literally was my first answer to prayer. That helped me.
Yes. And your last meeting, you understand?
Oh, yes. Yes. Very much so. Oh, I made some promises there, as you can well appreciate. And to the best of my ability, I think I've tried to fulfill these promises. And we've been very blessed with our family. So.
Is, after Stonewall, I'm going to ask you a few questions you've come in with.
I'm not worried about that.
Oh, okay. Was Steinwald the most difficult time for you?
Yes. It was the most intense. We were certainly under fire, but it was the most difficult time because it was our, for many of us, our first real baptism under fire. And under very rough circumstances. We should never, an armored division should never have been put in there. This has been written up and is used in the armor school, I understand, as an example of how not to use an armored division. So, no.
So that decision was made by generals up the way. Do you think they knew what they were sending you? and just leave?
No. I don't think they knew. This was at the time. I'm sure you've heard others talk about Operation Nordwind. Right. And the Germans had this enclave known as the Gamsheim Bridgehead. And the Germans were very much entrenched there. And it was not dislodged. My memory is, I think I read in our Hellcat news that the 42nd Infantry finally took it in February. And there were three or four divisions that had tried to take that out. But it was not an area for tanks because it was wide open fields. You'd get mired down. And it was cold, bitterly cold. But those tanks were pretty heavy, too. They could break through the ice and all of this sort of thing. And it was not a position, not a location for maneuver. I'm not a military strategist by any stretch of the imagination. I'm a research and development engineer. But, no, this, my understanding from reading some history, we were put in there when the Gaulle threatened to pull the his French forces out from under Eisenhower's command. And this was Eisenhower's response. He had to take this green armored division. That may have been because the bulge was going on full blast. Probably the only outfit he had available. I don't blame Eisenhower for putting us in there. Probably had no one else available. That's right.
After Steinwald, I'm assuming they finally pulled you back from...
Yes. They pulled us back. Our unit, we pulled back probably for about a week for a little R&R and restaffing.
Give me, okay, describe the numbers or to help us understand what Steinwald did to one unit. Tell me about your unit pre-Steinwald and after pre-Steinwald, numbers, etc.
We lost one tank in our assault gun platoon. We took on a Tiger tank, that little 75 millimeter pop gun, and the tank driver and the tank commander were the first Distinguished Service Crosses awarded in our division. Jimmy Lighthizer, the driver, was the only man that got out of that tank alive. Staffing. There were replacements that were brought in to bring all the units up to strength. There in Dunheim, and pre-staffed with green. Fresh green troops. We had one man in our assault gun platoon that had been in North Africa. And Clarence Curtis was one of our tank commanders. But he's the only one in my platoon that had had really prior combat experience. So.
Describe the relationships between. Those men you trained with, of course, you were kind of a newer replacement, but did the way you relate to me
No, change? I wasn't a replacement. In the usual sense. Yeah.
Yes,
ASTP, the ASTP guys were used to bring the unit up to full strength.
Okay. As you trained and everything, you had a really close relationship with his family. Explain, was, did there become a difference between the camaraderie or how you felt with the replacements? Did you have to change how you related to them?
Not really. Not really. Because I think the older guys, we just took the young, the new guys, that, hey, this is what we've been through. This is how we did it. And I don't think there was too much difficulty. I hope not. I was not one of the rifle companies, and you may have other engagements too.
I would like to, there's some questions I always ask people because I think it's really important for us to know, and I think I know the answer partial of this because of what you told us, but as you look back at World War II, what did you learn about yourself?
That, of course, is a very searching question. After we liberated the concentration camp at Landsberg.
You were there?
Yes. I literally learned how inhumane man can be toward his fellow man. I learned that I didn't quit. That's one thing I really learned at that young and tender age. And I just had my 20th birthday, which is a pretty young age to learn that. And I learned that you had to be discerning of people, that you had to look at the character of people to learn who you could trust, who you could confide in, if you confided at all, and rank was little importance in making a judgment call. And I learned that I didn't run. No man knows that until he's there. No man knows that until he's there. No person knows that until they've been confronted. Regardless of what the situation is. We think we do, but we don't really know what we're doing.
Those things that you learn about yourself, would you have been the same man, or how did those experiences change you? How do you think it's affected you?
That immediate answer to prayer probably had more impact than almost any other single event that has ever happened to me. And I have taken 600 volts DC without current limit right across the forearms, accidentally. And I should have been electrocuted then. That was in December of 1952 after I was, of course, I was working at that time. I should have been killed. This was the start of along the way of about 14 times when I either was near death or should have been killed. Going back to childhood illnesses, pre-penicillin. I had glomerulonephritis or strep infection in several of my kidneys that should have killed me. Sulfanilamide had been discovered 9 months prior. And then this event, this electrical shock, I survived that. I lost my ability to modulate my voice. I had to vary the pitch of my voice. I could still speak. But to a singer, that was devastating. And gradually I recovered. I just thank the Lord. I can truthfully say that my wife and I have been very blessed with three children, and both of our sons are ear, nose, and throat surgeons. Our daughter is a speech pathologist, and they're all believers. Our entire family is. What a praise.
I'm going to go back to Lane School.
Okay.
Just because that's an important, sad, awful, gruesome, terrible place. But it's a place that we need to remember.
Yes.
So can you tell me what you can about?
Well, I was on the radio at that time. And I remember pulling up to this place. And the I remember vividly five or six people, sexless, couldn't determine sex at all. They were just kind of staggering out of this doorway, and we knew what we had uncovered. And I remember getting some sea rations. We opened up a can with the biscuits in it. And we gave each of these guys a biscuit. But the reaction that I vividly remember is that they fought over the first biscuit. I mean, trying, because they had been reduced to that level. They were hardly people. They were walking skeletons. And this is the type of thing that the pictures that you have seen are absolutely true. We did see some dead bodies. I did not see a trench filled with dead bodies. I know a lot of guys did. I talked to one guy who was a photographer who was photographing many of these atrocities. And I asked him to describe a little. And he told me, I realize we have a lady present. You'll forgive me. He told me, I understand, he told me of, he photographed one man whose testicles, or scrotum, had been pulled and enlarged and hung down about 2 feet. This is the type of thing that was going on. If you can imagine that, this is, and I haven't told this to my family. They will learn this from the state. But I have I didn't watch any of the films of the Holocaust. Longest time until Schindler's List came out, and I finally watched that. Nor have I seen Saving Private Ryan. I see no reason to open up any more memories of that than I need to. So, but there were people, there were officers that did go back that were inside this camp. Oh, I went in. I was able to go in, and I saw some of their quarters, and where they kept these people. And the bunks that you see in the movies, very realistic. Very realistic. And that's what I saw. But the people that I saw were still living, and I did see a few dead bodies, but not the mass. I know what happened.
How did you personally? How did you survive? What does it mean?
Seeing that, I've had first of all, I guess you kind of suppress some of these experiences. I got back stateside. I wanted to get on with my life. This is an experience that I had. I wouldn't care to go through it again. Some of the experiences that I had, I'm sorry I had them, but some of them, I'm very thankful I had them. Part of growing up, I went in service as a kid, came out of the discharge as a man, thought very likely. Came back to Purdue. Finished, got my bachelor's in electrical engineering, and I got on with my life. And I soon realized that there were other veterans, but I soon learned that of the other veterans in the employ of the company where I worked, I'd not seen combat. And one noon at the lunch table, they were talking about some of their wartime experiences stateside. I had my belly full of it. And I got loose for about an hour, a half hour lunch. And I said, I don't want to hear any more of your wartime experiences back stateside. I walked out, and this is what I experienced. And you guys haven't seen anything like it. You don't know what war is about. And I think they respected me enough. I didn't hear another peep out of them. Of those experiences, I worked very closely with them. One was my best friend there.
If you were to leave a message for your family, for generations later, for people who would hear this tale, what would be your advice, or what would be the last thing you would do?
Recognize that God is real. That Christ is real. He lives in all of us, if we believe. That they will have many answers to prayer as I have had many answers to prayer. In professional situations, literally, that doesn't make any difference, really, how much money you make. It's how you utilize the money you do have, and how you treat people, how you relate with people. And try to leave the world a little better place than you found it. I think that's counsel that I would try to leave.
Well, I appreciate your time, and I'm sure I'll thank you.